Thank you. Thank you to the organizers, and thank you to my previous speakers, because they really have, this is much easier now. So my talk today is related to Taylor immunosuppression. And as Jean Leroute was commenting before, really the success of transplantation in part was really related to the development of new immunosuppressive drugs. And with this, the introduction of calcineurin inhibitors and the combination of the three standard initial immunosuppression, we were able to really improve survival to rates of 80-90% at 1 year, and to reduce the rejection rates to rates that are very variable among studies, as we just heard. Then we had an addition of new immunosuppressive drugs. And the question was really how we would use these newer drugs, whether we would add these newer drugs to the standard immunosuppression, and this would be a more powerful immunosuppression. And as Jean Leroute was commenting before, just the major aim in initial trials was really to reduce the degree of rejection. And so if we look first at the studies with mycophenolate, the addition of mycophenolate to the standard immunosuppression, it did lead to less acute rejection compared to azathioprine, but really similar side effects and similar long-term survival. And if we look at the data on anti-IL-2 receptor antibodies, again, the results from several studies showed less acute rejection, not in all studies, similar side effects, and similar short-term survival at 1 year. So these combinations, this new addition of the newer drugs to the standard immunosuppression, yes, it did appear to be more powerful, but as we just heard, and I'm going to use exactly the same slide as Jan, and I will go very fast over this, rejection really does not predict survival, and this was an initial study that he just commented, but there's been a more recent study by one of my colleagues in Spain, also looking at the impact of rejection on outcome, and showing really that there is not a relationship between the development of rejection and patient survival. And in fact, if we look at the data from the European Liver Transplant Registry, and I think, Jan, you use also the data from that European Liver Transplant Registry, we've seen over the years an improvement in the short-term survival. So if you look at patients transplanted more recently in the part of, on the left, you see that during the first 6 months post-transplantation, we're doing much better than several years ago, and this is likely related perhaps to immunosuppression, but particularly probably to surgical and anesthesiological techniques. But then, really, the long-term outcome after the first 6 months, 1 year, really the outcome has not changed much in patients that we transplanted 10 years ago compared to patients that we transplant now. One could say that yes, it does. It hasn't been changing very much, but the patients that we are transplanted are significantly sicker. They're more complicated patients. So in a way, we are doing somehow better. But really, if we look at the cause of death, both in the short and in the long term, you can see that graft rejection is really a minor cause of death in most transplant registry and most transplant units. And most of the cause of death are related to general complications, particularly cardiovascular disease, infections, non-tumoral recurrence, and then tumoral recurrence or de novo tumors. So we are left with problems with more systemic complication as the cause of medium-term and long-term mortality. And this is a study performed in the northern countries in Europe, again looking at long-term survival, similar to the study by Kim Ward and other studies looking at the population of transplant recipients and looking at the long-term survival and the cause of death in this long-term transplant survival and comparing the outcome to the general population of these northern countries. And as you can see, they had an excess mortality compared to the general population. But if you look at the cause of death in the transplant population, the majority of these deaths were related indeed to over-immunosuppression And they have causes as malignancy, cardiovascular disease, kidney disease, and infection as being the most common reasons of death in this transplant population. So I think, as Jan Leroux commented before, yes, we have more drugs, but really the addition of these compounds really doesn't lead to improved outcomes, and so we should somehow use these drugs in a way that we should reduce the long-term complications and effects of this combined immunosuppression, which is really particularly steroid-free immunosuppression due to the side effects of steroids and reduction of calcineurin inhibitor toxicity. And I just want to illustrate the problem, and again I will use data from some of the data that Jan Leroux presented. And this is a study that I think he also presented with quadruple therapy, very strong immunosuppression. This study showed a very low rate of acute cellular rejection of only 5%. But then in the long term, cholestatic HCV recurrence occurred in a third of the patients. New onset diabetes in 40% of the patients. 60% of the patients developed serious infections. And the 5-year survival was only 63%. If, on the other hand, we go to a center that uses a significantly less strong immunosuppression, with only tacrolimus combined with or without steroids, and they have the data showing that it doesn't really make a difference, then really the rate of complications such as new onset diabetes is only 8%, and the 5-year survival is 80%. With a really small rate of rejection. So we have several reasons that we need to tailor immunosuppression, as there is really no ideal protocol. The risk of rejection is not the same for all patients. There are certain agents that are deleterious for particular patients. For instance, steroids should be avoided, particularly in diabetic population and obese patients. Acute rejection, we've heard from Jan Leroux, and we've heard very interesting data now on the basic mechanism. It has not a clear impact on long-term survival in all patients. And I think the major cause issues that really late, the majority of late deaths are caused by side effects of immunosuppression. And the agents that we are currently using, they have different safety profile, so that we should perhaps use them in a different way to reduce these side effects. And so in order to really, the threats to long-term survival and reduce quality of life, I think they really come from malignant disease, from renal failure and cardiovascular disease with all the risk factors for cardiovascular disease and metabolic disease and obesity and bone disease. And I will just comment on these different complications and perhaps how we should tailor immunosuppression with regards to some of these indications. And I will start with hepatocellular recurrence, so patients who are transplanted for cancer. And there's been data from preliminary data from mouse model and also in human studies showing that high calcineurin inhibitor is associated with a worse outcome in terms of hepatocellular recurrence. This study was an interesting study because it looked really at the different risk factors for hepatocellular recurrence, which we know is not only immunosuppression, it's related to factors such as alpha fetoprotein. We spoke about this yesterday, the number of tumors, the response to local regional therapies. But what they found is really that if you combine these cancer-related features, high-risk features, to high calcineurin inhibitors, you increase substantially the risk of recurrence. And in that study, they had most of the patients, they were low-risk, they were in the group of low-risk factors. Recurrence was significantly higher in the patients who had a combination of high-risk factors. But if you add a high calcineurin inhibitor, you increase substantially this risk of recurrence, particularly in the group of patients who have other risk factors combined. There was a second study, also from my colleague in Spain, again looking at a retrospective analysis of a significant number of patients, 219 patients, at Royal Free Hospital and Reina Sofia University Hospital in Spain. And again, what they found is that there was a relationship between reduced exposure to calcineurin inhibitors and recurrence of hepatocellular carcinoma, so that patients with high CNI exposure, they had a significantly higher rate of cumulative recurrence of hepatocellular carcinoma, and this was one of the variables in the multivariate analysis which was associated with recurrence of cancer, together with other cancer-related features. Just to mention that Jan Lerout already spoke about this, the definition of high exposure, high immunosuppression, is extremely variable between studies. In this study, high exposure was defined as a mean trough concentration of TAC greater than 10 or cyclosporin greater than 300 within the first month after liver transplantation. But this definition has varied extraordinarily between. So there's been an attempt to look at mTOR inhibitors because of their potential impact on the pathways related to development of cancer, to look at the association, the potential impact of this drug to reduce the rate of HCC recurrence. And we heard one of the slides, or one of the studies that Jan Lerout commented. This is an analysis of the UNOS database. There were some initial retrospective studies suggesting that there might be a benefit of using mTOR inhibitors to reduce the recurrence of cancer in liver transplantation. And this was the first large study using the UNOS database with about 2,500 cancers compared to about 12,000 controls. And they looked at the impact of different immunosuppressive agents, and the sirolimus use was associated with a reduction in the percentage of patients with recurrence of hepatocellular carcinoma. And if you look at these patients who were transplanted for cancer in yellow, the use of sirolimus was associated with a reduced, decreased risk of mortality compared to the use of calcineurin or other drugs, particularly calcineurin inhibitors. There have been several meta-analyses and systematic reviews more recently, and I'm just showing this systematic review comparing the use of different immunosuppressive agents in terms of mortality and also recurrence of hepatocellular carcinoma. And this is one of these systematic reviews, and comparing the use of calcineurin inhibitors in green and the use of mTOR inhibitors in these studies, and showing a significant impact on outcome in these patients transplanted for hepatocellular carcinoma. There's also been a comparison studies using calcineurin inhibitors, sirolimus, and everolimus, and there seemed to be significant impact when they use everolimus, but most of the studies using everolimus, the follow-up in these patients was significantly short, so I don't think we can really make comments on this finding. And finally, there's never something perfect, so we come to really the prospective, randomized, open-label study comparing sirolimus-based immunosuppression to the standard immunosuppression without mTOR inhibitors, and this was a prospective study with some limitations, though. They started with 525 patients. Group A were patients without sirolimus, the standard immunosuppression, and group B were the patient where sirolimus was introduced, and then calcineurin inhibitors were either stopped or were continued at reduced doses. But I just want to mention that the number of patients that started the study was significantly higher, 50% higher than the number of patients that finished the study. And there was a lot of patients who just went from one arm to the other arm. So it's a little bit difficult to really come up with valid findings from this study. But at the end, the study was negative, and this is just a really prospective study showing that the outcome in terms of recurrence-free survival, HCC recurrence-free survival in the patients which were randomized to the sirolimus arm was exactly the same as that found in the patients that were randomized to the non-sirolimus arm. So really putting into controversial idea about the impact of mTOR inhibitors with regards to recurrence of hepatocellular carcinoma. So I do think there are drugs which have a pro-oncogenic effect that has been shown both in preliminary study and also in clinical studies, and that there are drugs that have an anti-angiogenic and anti-proliferative effect, but the evidence that is there for these drugs is still, I think, not completely convincing. I will now switch to chronic kidney disease, and I know there's a speaker now talking about chronic kidney disease and the impact of immunosuppression, so I would just like to mention a couple of slides on chronic kidney disease because it's really a major issue in our transplant population. This is a study looking at GFR over time and looking how the patients, number of patients with normal kidney function over time is reduced substantially compared to patients who develop really advanced kidney disease in the long term, which really increases significantly over time in the liver transplant population. And this is happening more so now that we are transplanting patients with a higher MELD score. And we know that many studies have shown by multivariate analysis that impaired kidney function has in the end a significant negative impact in patient survival. So we also know there have been studies and systematic reviews, and this is one of these systematic reviews, that calcineurin inhibitors at high doses will lead to kidney failure. And there's been studies showing that if you are able to reduce tacrolimus levels less than 10 in the first month post-transplantation, this will lead to a reduction by half of the risk of renal failure. So we need to try to use our immunosuppressive drugs in a way that we don't surpass this kind of cutoff to reduce the risk of renal failure. And I think renal failure and reducing the risk of renal failure is important because renal failure is associated with many other conditions. And if we now switch to cardiovascular disease post-transplantation, the risk of cardiovascular events after liver transplantation increases over time. But if we reach the 10 years, surpass the 10 first year of transplantation, that risk significantly increase afterwards. So it's a cause of death and it's a cause of low quality of life, which really will increase after we follow our patients for more than 10 years. And if we look at the risk factors to develop cardiovascular disease in the long term, renal function, renal dysfunction, both at the time of transplantation and 1 year after transplantation, is a significant factor impacting the development of cardiovascular disease, together to the already known risk factors which are associated with cardiovascular disease. So we know that cardiovascular disease increases over time, and this is very logical because all the risk factors that are associated with cardiovascular disease increase substantially over time, both in terms of obesity, body mass index, in terms of the percentage of patients developing obesity, arterial hypertension, diabetes, and renal insufficiency, as we just saw in the previous slide. And in fact, if you look at the number of patients with more than three of these risk factors, it is less than 1% at transplantation, but it increases up to almost 40% of the patients that have more than of these three risk factors for cardiovascular disease at 10 years post-transplantation. And if you compare the Framingham risk score at the time of transplantation in red, one-third of the patients have a low Framingham score, one-third moderate, one-third high. But if you look at 1 year after transplantation, the vast majority of the patients have a high Framingham score. Thus, patients are really at increased risk of developing cardiovascular disease. So what can we do in terms of immunosuppression? And unfortunately, we can reduce calcineurin inhibitors levels to reduce the risk of renal failure. We could potentially have also an impact in terms of other complications, metabolic complications such as arterial hypertension, diabetes, dyslipidemia. But the data there is, again, is very confusing. And I'll go show you just one meta-analysis, a systematic review and meta-analysis, which was just recently published, looking at steroid-sparing protocols for following non-renal transplant, and particularly looking at the liver transplant recipients. And if you look at the different the impact of these steroid-sparing protocols in terms of diabetes, arterial hypertension, cholesterol, and triglycerides, really the impact is not that substantial, and there's really only significant in terms of diabetes mellitus, but really doesn't have such an impact in arterial hypertension or in cholesterol levels. So we are not yet there in terms of how we need to manage immunosuppression to reduce these side effects, and we probably need to impact these side effects, perhaps moving to other way to really try to reduce these comorbid conditions, in particular with exercise, diet, and multi-approach. And I will just like to finish with the recurrence of primary diseases. I think HCV is no longer a problem, so I will not comment on millions of studies that have been published on the potential of impact of immunosuppression on recurrent hepatitis C, because now we have the drugs, but I will just focus a little bit on autoimmune-based diseases. And again, this was a systematic review on the potential impact of different risk factors on recurrence of autoimmune hepatitis, or recurrence of PBC, and recurrence of PSC. And most of the studies in terms of autoimmune diseases have shown that the discontinuation of prednisone may be deleterious in these patients in terms of the recurrence of autoimmune disease. And in some studies, the use of either cyclosporine or tacrolimus was associated with the recurrence of some of these autoimmune diseases. And for instance, there are data from some studies, there's data, interesting data from King's College also, showing that recurrence of PBC may be related to the type of calcineurin inhibitor that you're using, and that this recurrence of PBC may be greater when you use tacrolimus with or compared to cyclosporine. But this may be perhaps related that the patients who were on cyclosporine, most of these patients were also on steroids, and this might be the relationship, the explanation for the association, although there may be more for that. So I think we need to take into account also these autoimmune diseases when we want to tailor immunosuppression. So I think in conclusion, there are, as Jan said, many reasons to individualize immunosuppression, and we have the agents to do so. And this is because we want our patients to live longer and to live better. And many of these agents have different toxic profiles. And we want to reduce disease recurrence and de novo diseases. I think the process would probably expand in, we just heard very interesting data, if we had a reliable method which was simple enough to really define what's the good immunosuppression, whether our patient is with 500 mycophenolate and 2 milligrams of Advagraf is really in his best immunosuppressive moment compared to other different combination of immunosuppression. And I would like just to finish that NASH is an emerging challenge in liver transplantation. I think it's everywhere in the world, but it's probably much more, it's already there in the United States compared to other countries. And NASH has been shown in many studies to be an independent risk factor for post-transplant renal dysfunction, and also an independent factor for mortality related to cardiovascular disease. So we need to be very careful, and really in the NASH population, we should try, it should be really our population where we should really try to individualize and optimize immunosuppression. Thank you very much for your attention.